technology that was once never seen outside of science fiction movies is now here. And much of that tech, autonomous vehicles, smart home assistants, robotics, among other innovations, is powered by AI, artificial intelligence. We have assembled a panel of AI experts to discuss how AI will radically change every aspect of our lives and what it's like for a person of color to work in this exciting, transformative field. Oh, Lord. Getting to that afternoon time. Y'all know what it is. Okay. So today we are joined by Gloria Boyland. She's the Corporate Vice President of Operations and Service Support for FedEx. Gloria is responsible for evaluation and leadership of priority operational developments, service quality improvements, customer experience improvements, and new service offerings. Then we'll have Debo Olo J. Bicon. He is the Chief Technology Officer and co-founder of Gigster, a smart software development service utilized by major companies like Staples and MasterCard. Gigster drives the adoption of machine learning and success of data-driven products within enterprise. And then lastly, we have Dr. Kareem Youssef. Dr. Youssef is the GM of Watson IoT, an IBM business unit focused on helping clients in asset-intensive industries as they maximize value for their connected assets, leveraging insights and AI. Our moderator for this session is Samara Lin, Digital Manager for Black Enterprise. So let's welcome out all those incredible people.
All right, well, good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to the AI session. AI, of course, meaning artificial intelligence, and we have some of the best experts in the field right here. I'm gonna start, first of all, Debo, just say your name so we all have the pronunciation down.
Debo Ola Shebikon.
Ola Shebikon, okay, yeah. Okay, beautiful. Okay, so we got that. So I think what I wanna do is go down the line and ask each of you to detail what your work specifically is in artificial intelligence. And Gloria, can we start with you?
Sure, we can. First, let me just disabuse you of the notion that I am an AI expert. There are people who work for me who are AI experts, but I don't want to perpetrate a fraud up here. What my team does at FedEx is essentially we are the Center for Advanced Analytics, Operation Research, and identifying and applying advanced technologies for FedEx. So everything from artificial intelligence to its related field, machine learning and automation, electrification. So everything that is on the periphery, on the edge, that we think would be a benefit to FedEx. We create tools, we run pilots, and we do research and development.
Very cool, okay. Debo, what about you? What are you doing in AI?
Yeah, so I was sitting here trying to think about whether I should crack this joke. So
go ahead.
If you're thinking about it, it probably isn't a good joke. But people say AI is like something. A lot of people talk about it, but no one's doing it. So you can fill in the blank. But so I see Gigster's role as...
I don't get it.
Okay, don't worry. We talk offline. Gigster's role is to make AI real in actual, you know, actually real in enterprises.
And Gigster is your startup.
Gigster's my company. So essentially, the way we do it, we do two things with AI. One is we look across industries. We've got a lot of customers in various industries. We've done over 1,500 projects at this point for large enterprises. And we say, you know, this is how you should use AI within your company. And we actually, you know, use our network of freelancers to build out AI solutions for customers. And we build tools inside of Gigster that allow us to deliver these AI projects very efficiently. The second thing is that through the actual process of delivering software for clients, we track and we measure all kinds of pieces of information about how we're doing the projects so that we ourselves can get better over time at doing that. So there's use of data internally for our own processes, and then there's also the delivery of AI projects into large enterprises.
Very good, thank you. And Kareem, really Watson at IBM is really the kickoff for mainstream knowledge about AI for most of the public. Can you talk a little bit about what you're doing with IBM? And
so I run a software business unit, and there we look at how we apply Watson in what I would call industrial use cases. So like in things like facilities optimization, physical asset management, so using AI to solve kind of predictive maintenance problems, energy optimization in building type problems, embedding AI in cars as an example, so you can interact with a car and it can proactively interact with you. Those are the things we do within Watson IoT. So it's very much driven around receiving data from physical things, industrial equipment, vehicles, buildings, driving new AI solutions based upon that.
Just a show of hands, is anyone currently using AI in any of their apps or their startups or any of their companies? And does everyone have a pretty good idea of what AI entails? Okay, so I think the term tends to get really buzzworded around.
Yep.
You know, when you think of AI, you tend to think, we played the Star Wars theme, you think of these machines and rising up to kill us all. But actually, we have AI in our phones. Maybe you can share with the audience some of the real-world examples, either in your companies or on our phones, where we're using AI every day. Gloria, do you want to start off with that?
You know, our company, we're built on PSP philosophy, as we go, people, service, profit. And you'll find that we actually have very real business applications for artificial intelligence across all of those, each of those. For people, we've used artificial intelligence, which is, you know, at its base, big data with logic that you can actually get outcomes from, either decisions or change behavior. So with people, we have looked at, for example, what causes accidents in our yard and on the road, and we've used artificial intelligence to create the history that tells us what alerts we should give drivers. So if you're a driver and you're on your route, or if you're a long haul driver, the folks who drive 300 plus miles a day, we've used that to say, at what point in that journey could we have an indicator that a driver needs help because they're tired, because they're lost, et cetera, and we're applying that to help enhance their work. In another example, we've actually used AI to look at differences in that e-commerce are making and what people buy, where it comes from, where they live, how much, in order to improve our network. So we can take all of that information and say, okay, in our upcoming peak season, which is Christmas, where will the volume be? Where will people be buying? How much of it? Where will we have to take it so that we can dial that back into our planning processes, which gives us the opportunity to have the people in the trucks where they need to be, but also, most critically, be able to flex very quickly because we can use all that data to adjust.
Gotcha, gotcha. Debo, what are some examples, maybe on a smartphone, where people are using AI every day?
There are a couple examples. So when you use your phone, you speak to your phone and it understands what you're saying. That is an example of converting speech into something that the computer can understand. And that's trained on lots and lots and lots of audio and sort of natural language pairs. And so some system has been trained to understand, you know, English, French, whatever the language is, the voice of someone, translate that into some kind of symbol or some kind of natural language that can then trigger an action. Something that's super obvious, in that we use it all the time, but we probably don't think of it as AI, is Google search. You use Google search in a smartphone. And I would say that's probably one of the super early examples of AI, in that almost all of the searches you're doing are powered by some kind of machine learning system that is saying, you know, this is the most likely result for the search, and given that you're the person searching and you've clicked on these kinds of things before, these are the things to show you. So, you know, Google search, kind of any speech-to-text application, and then any translation. So you find a website in this language, translate it to another language. Your Facebook app, when you're looking at a photo and it's, you know, recommending who you should tag in the photo because it's identifying people, that is AI. Also, if you're using Google Photos and you take pictures and it's recognizing your baby, even you know before you've told it that's your baby, things like that, those are examples of AI. And I'd just say broadly, computers, you say computers have been getting smarter over time. The main way they've been getting smarter is by just becoming more performant. So there are more transistors, the computers are more powerful, and so they can do the same thing they've always been doing, but faster and cheaper. Now, when the reason there's all this hype about AI is because we believe that they're starting to get a different kind of capability. So they're qualitatively different. They're not just stronger and more powerful. They can actually do different things. And you can think of the things that they're now learning to do as being similar to the things that we, as human beings, take for granted. So we can see things, we can hear things, we can speak, we can recognize patterns. So imagine that computers are now getting the ability to do that. So all of the things I gave as examples now, they fall into this bucket of either the computer is able to see things now, it's able to hear things, it's able to understand language, or able to speak back to us. There was a demo Google did recently where a machine was talking to, I think it was a restaurant or something, it was booking, making a restaurant reservation completely automatically, and the person on the other side had no idea that they were talking to a robot. So the capabilities we're talking about right now are kind of moving away from just rules where you can crunch numbers and moving more into things that you would typically associate with your human senses.
Wow. Kareem, you know, as I mentioned, Watson kind of kicked off the AI frenzy for a lot of us and gave us awareness. What are some ways Watson is out there with the AI platform? How is it being used currently?
Yeah, so Watson's being used in a couple of ways. I just want to build on a point Debo made, which is when you think about how we programmed computers in the past, and indeed we still program them this way, it was very much a notion of procedural instruction. Now, regardless of whatever paradigm you go with, actual procedural or objects speaking to each other, it was very much you solved the problem by describing what needed to be done. In the space of the problems that Debo used as an example, and I'll build upon as we talk about Watson, you can't program the computer with a procedural instruction, right? There's no way to say, hey, this is the baby's face, and this is the baby's face, and you know, you've got to actually train it with data. And that's why you hear when we talk about AI, we talk a lot about machine learning, right? You have to train it and kind of synthesize from data patterns that can be used. And so invariably, what you find in this entire discussion and in the problem spaces that we solve, they are actually quite easy to solve as humans. They are particularly challenging to get computers to do them. So when Watson began, it started with one of the most challenging problems to really push this art forward, which is understanding speech, synthesizing, and responding, right? When we think about how we learn, right, none of us, I suspect, if we sat down, could describe how we learned how to speak. Let's go with English language, since I'll assume that's the most common language here in the room. We just know that we have words, and we somehow understand and associate meaning with them. Now, you have to actually use data to train the computer to begin to do that, to tend to understand inflections, right? What is it a joke? Is it not a joke? Double entendre, stuff like that. And so Watson began with solving that problem. Where the Watson platform has moved to in itself has been picking on a number of those problems and creating kind of reusable services from them. So we have a visual API for doing recognition against images. We have the speech-to-text, text-to-speech type conversation. We have actually something we just released a couple of weeks ago, which is solving an interesting problem, which is looking at detecting bias in training data. Because when the data you use to train a computer can also imbue bias in its thinking, just like you can imbue bias in a human, right? So we've done those kind of things. Where I focus is taking that base platform and applying it to a specific domain. In my case, industrial. I have colleagues who work in health, as an example, others who work in talent and HR. And just to give you a quick example of what we're working on or what we build when you think about taking these pieces, we talked about visual recognition. So imagine a manufacturing plant and inspecting LCD panels, right? You can actually train the computer, and so we've trained Watson to be able to inspect LCD panels by taking lots of pictures, right, of good ones, bad ones, mediocre ones. And so you can use that as a training data set, and now on a high-speed production line with a camera, kind of detect faults in LCD panels and move them offline for further visual inspection. That is great savings and optimization in terms of labor for a manufacturing plant, right?
Sure.
So that's how these things begin to connect from the art of the possible to applying it to real world use cases to providing actual value to businesses.
Great, okay. Gloria, what do you think is the biggest benefit of AI for humanity? And then what do you think is the most worst negative possible outcome?
Oh, for humanity, that's a big question.
Or business, or what do you think is the most positive aspect of it?
Well, you know, as I've already sort of inferred, we see artificial intelligence and the applications, like automation is an application of artificial intelligence. The voice recognition for us helps in customer service because it allows us, when a customer calls in, which is something we're experimenting with, to be able through our, without talking to a human, to understand if the person is really irate or if they're just confused, et cetera. So there are all sorts of benefits to improving interactions with business and other machines, which is what a IVR is, as well as just making everyone's life easier. The most intriguing thing I've seen was the message, I think the announcement was about a week ago, where a couple of the tech companies are joining together with global organizations to see if artificial intelligence can predict famines. So we have an opportunity if the technology and the ability gets smarter, and that it learns the way we do by experiencing history, et cetera. All of the pictures say, this is what's happening out there, and helps them learn. So if we can learn things and give the computers through the data enough information, perhaps they'll be successful and we'll be able to predict and avoid famine.
Yeah, that would be incredible. Yeah. And the worst thing, what do you think is the thing we have to be careful of?
I think the thing we have to be careful of is the hype itself. Machines are learning in much the way we do as human beings. So one, it means that we have to be very careful about the data we give the machines. And if that data is corrupt, it can be used for corrupt ends, right? Any powerful tool can be misused. The other thing is the forgetting that the machine still does not have some of the context that we as human beings bring to decision makers making. So the machine is faster. The machine can be more accurate when it is not a very complex or even some complex, but a machine will never be able to replace a human being's ability to provide human judgment, which largely comes from experience and context.
Right, very true. And Debo, I think, and just correct me if I'm wrong, I think a lot of what Facebook uses to flag content and posts is the baseline is AI. And I think that's where a lot of this conflict comes in about people saying, well, these posts are being flagged and these aren't. And really, the bottom line of that is kind of what Gloria was saying, is that machines don't understand context. Do you see that as one of the pitfalls of AI? Or what, in your opinion, is the most positive aspect of AI, and what is the most negative?
Good question. I can touch on that really quickly and then give my answer. I think there's, he was mentioning the problem of bias, and another big problem is one of interpretability, which is, I think, what you're touching on there, which is some, you know, these machine learning models are so complicated. You know, you've heard of neural networks. Sometimes there are, you know, super, super deep neural networks with millions of parameters, and we throw data into it, we get something out, and we're like, yay, it worked. We actually have no idea how it worked, you know? So when you go on Amazon and it says, or Netflix, and it says, we're showing you this movie because you like this other movie, that's an example of being able to explain, you know, the recommendation, of being able to interpret what the model is doing. And when you go on Amazon and says, oh, you bought this book, so we're showing you this other book. But we're starting to get models that you can't do that with. They're just way more complicated. There are all kinds of crazy things going on inside of them that actually led to that recommendation. So you can't just easily say, oh, it was because of this, that's why we showed you this. You can imagine in certain areas like flagging a post, or even perhaps more critical areas like finance, where you want to approve a loan for someone and it gets denied, or healthcare, where you diagnose someone as being sick or having cancer versus not, and you can't explain what you're doing. This is one of the big things that you rely on humans to be able to do in both these applications. So that's a very big area of research and focus right now, where people are trying to build tools that allow you to kind of poke at the model and say, why did it do this? Why didn't it say that? Or even just automatically tell you what it's doing. For me, I think the biggest positive of AI is that we can end up in a world where we are doing the things that we're uniquely qualified to do as humans, right? Like, we care for each other, we love each other, we crack jokes, we are creative, we come up with brilliant ideas. Like, those kinds of things, that's what we should be doing. We shouldn't be like, I don't want to name specific tasks, but there are lots of tasks that you and I wake up every day and have to do, and we're like, why the hell do we have to do this? So I think that if you fast forward to a world where AI is doing all that stuff, and we're just kind of writing poetry, making music, being creative, that's the positive limit in my mind, is that it automates repetitive work. The flip side of it, though, which is also related to that, is that it may displace a lot of jobs, and that's the thing that we got to be worried about. So in this, there's some time frame where it's going to do all this repetitive work for us, but in that time frame, it's probably getting rid of a bunch of jobs that we have right now. And sure, we can train people and we can create new jobs with AI, but there'll be some time period where there are probably a bunch of people who are displaced, and we have to think very seriously about that. So that's the thing that the thing I'm most concerned about, even given the promise of AI.
Yeah, I want to address that. Kareem, I was reading a study where it says that AI's already displaced a lot more jobs than we originally thought. Is that something that IBM is addressing with technologies like Watson? And if so, how?
So I've come at this job displacement thing a little bit differently, I think, than the norm. I think if you step back and look at any technology or industrial revolution, jobs change in form, shape, and size constantly for a whole variety of reasons. There used to be a time we would number crunch with a calculator. Then we got spreadsheets, right? We moved on from spreadsheets. We now use analytics software, right? I think that my view is that I don't truly subscribe to AI displacing jobs as in it inherently displaces jobs in its own right, right? I feel personally that AI is all about decision support. That's where we're actually seeing true benefits of AI. It's in supporting decisions that humans and professionals have to make. Now, what you begin to find, and this is true, that as you look through, how AI can be used to help make decisions or support decisions and automate tasks, you begin to remove some of the mundane tasks, right? And so your question would be, let's pick a warehouse and kind of picking something off the shelf to ship, right? Could you train a robot to run down the shelf, pick it up, move it, and does that therefore displace the warehouse worker, potentially? But then, to be honest with you, there's jobs being created around how do you document that domain knowledge, how do you maintain that robot, and a host of other things. Our focus, I think, within IBM has really been on looking at what does it take to continue to reskill and drive new, kind of education programs to give people opportunity to continue to participate in what you might call a new economy. I think that's where the focus should be. I think we find a constant renewal of jobs driven by any technological evolution. I don't think AI is unique in this or particularly at fault for it. And I honestly, if you really operate in the world of AI, you will truly recognize how fascinating the human mind itself is and how, quite frankly, irreplaceable the human is. And so I just really think about it's a constant shift to higher value, different value, and part of what we try to do is to enable that.
And Gloria, actually, this is a good question for you because, FedEx is this huge corporation. A large percentage of its workforce are drivers, people out in the fleet. We're having smart cars. We're going to have autonomous vehicles. Is there talk about FedEx, about these thousands and thousands of workers being replaced by smart technology?
Well, the question of what the workforce needs to be is very much an ongoing conversation at FedEx. And as I've said, we sort of see this, I guess, in very much the same way that these gentlemen do. The advancement, we'll use autonomous cars as an example. The advancement is inevitable. That will bring very clear benefits to some of those same drivers, because there is a long roadway between today and when you literally would not need a human being sitting in a vehicle. And so between there, we get a lot of enhancements to the productivity of a driver, but also their comfort. Paying attention on a 300-mile run is taxing on a human being. So incremental advancements in the ability of that vehicle to make decisions, pilot itself, tell us what's going on with that driver, all of which is artificial intelligence, is a benefit. Automation also enhances productivity. The day that you would not need a driver, particularly in the cab, we think is far off, but when it is, for us, it's clear that it creates a new job for those same folks, because they are not fixed skill in the way that people think they are. There will be drivers who will have to monitor those vehicles. They have the experience of driving. They will be teaching those autonomous cars for many years to come. So new jobs will be created as old jobs are phased out. And we think those new jobs will be more attractive to our workforce.
Totally agree.
So we have a couple of minutes left. I want to just get one quick last question before we open up to audience questions. You know, one of the dangers of fast-moving technology like AI is that people will be left behind in the workforce, as you mentioned, Kareem, with that shifting period. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, probably a lot of those people will be black and brown people. How do we get more people of color into this particular technology space? And what do we need to do to educate our children as early as possible so they are valuable members of this workforce? Gloria, do you want to start, and then we'll just go down the line?
Well, you know, to be successful in the world to come, three basic things. Mathematical knowledge, actually decision-making skills, as well as a concrete skill. I know how to code, et cetera, right? And so, to my mind, what we need to be thinking of is how well are our children equipped around scientific process? How well do they use information and data in order to make decisions? Do they understand that? Are they comfortable? And that can start the day they enter first grade. So we can start now. If you're already an adult, there's an opportunity, as so long as you have a basic competency in those areas, scientific process. I have a hypothesis, I pull together the information, I test it, and I retest until I understand the outcome. We all learned that. So taking what we have today and translating it to one of the many jobs that are available because of AI, I think is a significant opportunity. We just have to focus on it. Not everyone has to be a coder.
Right.
There are lots of other jobs that come before you ever put one piece of code into the system, and then afterwards.
Great, great. And Debo, what about you? What do we need to get more people that look like us in the space, and what do the kids need?
Yeah, I think the only thing I would add to that great answer is for AI to work, you need to apply to a domain. And so you typically need a domain expert and a technical expert. And so even if you have zero understanding of coding, zero understanding of computer science, you can help today build AI solutions. If I'm an AI expert and I have no idea how farming works, I can't do anything, I can't make any progress. If I have no idea how IoT works, what does predictive maintenance even mean? What does the factory care about? I can't do anything. So you're actually extremely valuable if you have any kind of domain expertise, because most AI experts don't have this domain expertise. They know a lot about computer science, they know a lot about data science, but they don't actually have this domain expertise. So if you think, wow, there's some process in my job that could be automated or could be streamlined or where I could get decision kind of support, and you pair up with someone who is an AI expert, you can actually create really valuable solutions, really valuable companies, really valuable products for the companies that you work in. So that's what I would add. And then for kids, I think it's, you know, it's not unique to AI. Just we just need to get our kids excited about science, excited about mathematics, excited about STEM, and we can kind of catch them young. But I think for adults, if you're a domain expert, which you probably are in some domain, just start working with folks who are technical experts, and you'll be surprised what you can create.
And by domain expert, you mean just you're expert in your particular field.
Yeah, you're a marketing expert.
Right, because even media is incorporating AI now.
Yeah, like you're a media person, you want to figure out how you can do closed captioning of your videos automatically. And you know, you'd have to, you would know that that's a big problem inside your company. And you would take that to a technical person and collaborate on a solution.
Gotcha. And Karim, I saw you nodding.
I'd really would build from that. I think this is part of the danger of the hype. And one thing we need to be careful of, as a constituency, if you like, is not just running to something as defined, but understanding what it really means. If you just think about delivering an AI solution, right, just think about providing an application, what are the job opportunities around that? Marketing it, writing about it, preparing the content for it, selling it, accountants. I mean, it's still, all these things still apply.
Right.
And I definitely echo the part of domain knowledge. So not everybody needs to be a coder. Not everybody needs to be a data scientist, right? And so for the kids, the thing that stands out for me, that I know we like to talk about STEM and all that a lot. I'm on critical thinking. I think the thing that we need to teach kids the most as we bring them up is how to think critically. Right? Because that then allows you to play in this evolving world in any way that actually makes sense. I don't want to sell short anything, right? You know, it's not, when I was growing up, it was be an engineer, doctor, or teacher. Those were the only three things my parents would pay for, right? There are many ways to make a, some of you know what I'm talking about, right?
No lawyer.
Yeah, no, they didn't buy the lawyer much. They were like teacher. But if you did English, you could kind of
careful,
get to
I
law
was
school.
A lawyer.
No, I'm just saying. It was very rigid. I want us to be careful not to view this evolution, and this is another technological evolution, too rigidly. And as we prepare our kids and even ourselves, be very expansive in how we engage.
Wonderful. I think we have time for a couple of quick questions, especially if you have any questions for these, this panel about how AI may be implemented into your business. I guess we'll start right there.
Thank you. I'm Keita Broadwater. I'm the founder of Oxygen AI. Our work relies heavily on data science and machine learning. More recently, our clients have shown an increased interest in data governance and ethics, and because of regulation and because of their own ethics. One regulation in the EU comes to mind that says
GDPR.
That if an algorithm made a decision that had an adverse effect on you, like maybe a loan decline or maybe a law enforcement decision, you have the right to know why.
Yes.
So I'd like to know, in your work or in your clients' worlds, how is this impacting their policy for data governance, and how is this impacting what they're doing with with their data or with the algorithms?
If I may lead with that one.
Gloria?
For us, this notion of data governance is so critical to all we do because we focus on building AI for the enterprise. So it starts from the notion of what data can we use and how can that data be protected. It moves all the way through to the provenance of the logic that, the provenance of the answers that have come out. Debo made that point, and I think we're finding it to be ever so critical, right? This is the reason why when we talk about AI, some people talk about machine learning, which is really just, to my mind, a mathematical technique. We talk about cognitive and we talk about reasoning. You have to be able to explain how the answers come out. And so for us who focus on supplying AI for the enterprise, I mean, these conversations are central to literally anything that we do. Because when you're providing something that can predict a machine can fail, for example, and people build their maintenance policy on that, well, there's many an implication that you can wind up from that. So it's very central to our thinking, and it's shaping not only how we build our own stuff, but then also the tools we're providing to others to look, like I talked about, to our trust and compliance suite, to be able to achieve the same.
And Gloria, did you want to touch on that as well?
No, I would just echo, as one of his customers, he must bring to FedEx a cohesive and comprehensive way to both collect, create, and protect that data and manage it going forward. There was a responsibility to our customers. There's a responsibility to our shareholders and our employees that we know that we have faith in and control of all of the data that's created to support AI.
I'm going to bounce back and forth across the room. Go ahead.
Hi, my name is Ainge. I'm the founder of Waterping, which helps you stay hydrated while you're at your desk. So I'm not sure if you guys seen an interview. There's an interview with Elon Musk, and he was talking about AI. If you haven't seen, I'm not making this up, but he painted this grim scenario where our brains are going to be connected to AI and this weird sort of future. And it's an actual interview with Seth Rogen, I think it was.
But I saw it.
Yeah, it was pretty grim. And I'm just like, is he crazy? Or is this like a real thing?
Yeah, he kind of is.
And that's my question.
Well, that's a good point. How smart can AI get? Or is it going to be like, you know, that movie WALL-E, where we're just like these floating bodies and the robots and all the technology is doing everything? Are we going to get to that point?
Yeah, I think you're talking about the interview with Joe Rogan. And I actually don't think he's crazy, but I don't think that what he was saying there is that crazy. It's basically offering a new way to view what AI really is. The question is, we are people who already use smartphones, we already use Google search, we already use the internet. And the question is, if you compared you today to a person 100 years ago, how much smarter are you than that person 100 years ago? Like, a lot smarter. If you combine the fact that you have access to information at your fingertips, the fact that you can figure out the capital of any country, you know, within a microsecond, that's ridiculous. If you wrap that intelligence that the internet is providing you around a person, and you define that as intelligence or as artificial intelligence, that is way, way, way beyond anything that anyone had centuries ago. So he's saying we need to recognize the fact that we are already connected to the matrix in a sense. We're already connected to the internet, and we already kind of one. If you look at the whole system as one thing, it's a very, very intelligent, very, very powerful system that no one controls. No one of us controls how the other interacts with the internet. So it's just a different way of viewing things. And if you define intelligence that way, it's the power of that network is getting exponentially stronger year over year.
Yeah, we're on our way to becoming cyborgs, which
we
I
are.
Think is kind of cool.
We are cyborgs, so. This is point.
Hi, my name is Duru Ahanatu. I'm director of data science and engineering at Oath, which is a Verizon company. You kind of touched on this a little bit already, but I was just curious to get a little bit more detail on the tools you're talking about for testing out machine learning algorithms, you know, to be able to explain how they work. Because Debo, you talked about pairing up domain experts with, coders and machine learning experts, but the domain experts are often very uncomfortable if the machine learning person can't explain exactly how the results came about.
Yeah, I can touch a little bit. So one thing is to just use simpler algorithms to get started, right? To get like, what is the core of what's going on here? So imagine you're trying to predict the price of a house. You may say, well, location may matter, the number of rooms in the house may matter. These things are called features. So the features that are important to the problem define kind of the solution of the problem. And so if I pick these features and I use a very simple algorithm, like, you know, if there are three rooms and if it's in San Francisco, then the price is blah. I can use an algorithm like a tree, like a decision tree that goes like this and decides what the price is, or a more complicated one, which is a collection of a bunch of trees called a random forest, and I could use that to predict the price of the house. So as data scientist or as the machine learning expert, it's kind of on you. You know, the first line of action is to try to do the simplest possible solution to a problem where it's very clear what the features are, how the features interact, and like someone can kind of understand that. So it's a pretty big problem where people just jump to the most complicated way to solve a problem all the time. So first thing, don't do that, and then it's easier to explain. Second is when you do have to use these more complicated models and you can't really do something simpler first, then there's a lot of work in visualizing what's actually going on inside the algorithm. For example, for something that's trying to classify whether an image contains a dog or a cat, you'd feed it with an image, you know, at the start that's just a bunch of pixels that says, you know, for the image. But when you look inside the neural network, you start to see that the neural network is starting to recognize like the ear of a cat or the eye of a cat or the face. And so if we build tools that allow us to visualize what's actually going on inside the algorithms, then it allows you as a domain expert, you know, in that case it's obvious. You can say that's an ear, that's an eye. But if the problem is more complicated, the domain expert can kind of see what's going on inside the algorithm and say, oh, I see what it's doing. It's noticing this thing and noticing that thing. So tools to visualize these algorithms and also starting out with much simpler approaches, those are some ways that we can tackle this. And they are obviously more sophisticated efforts people are undertaking.
The thing I'd like to echo here so that we don't, because we keep talking about losing jobs and the like, the amount of human brain power, judgment, conceptual thinking you have to apply to even figuring out what machine learning algorithm, how you want to do, what tools, as I talked about, trust and compliance tools that we have built at IBM, how you're going to apply them. There is still so much human domain in figuring this stuff out to get some useful work out. There's, you know, computers can't replace that, right, anytime soon. And so I really liked what you described there, but I just thought I wanted to echo the fact that part of it is also still being the human in the loop, right? You know, you still need the humans in the loop communicating together, as always you have had in these situations.
Yeah, I would just add to that, one of the most important things you can do in that partnership between the technical expert and the domain expert, otherwise known as, you know, regular functions to the rest of us, is to make sure that you have an understanding and an agreement ahead of time as to all of the attributes and requirements that go into that model and what's most important. Because regardless of how smart the model is, if your domain expert cannot make sense of what they're seeing, if it's counterintuitive particularly, you're gonna have to go back and, as you said, sort of pull it back, make it simple, and start over. So agreement up front, what's important, what should be in the model, and how will we look at the results?
That's a great point. It's that human nuance that is still so critical. So thank you. Sir?
Hello, my name is Gary Lila, and I have a question regarding
Speak up? Yeah, can you speak in the mic a little bit more? There you go.
Oh, my name is Gary Lila. I have a question regarding what Samara and Gloria said earlier regarding context and how good your AI is. So for each person on the panel, what does your team do once they've seen the results in the field? How do they feed that back into back to the engineering team to help improve those models? How often is it updated so that the machine actually have domain, actual field knowledge into the system?
It's a good question. Gloria, do you want to start and we'll just go down the line?
Sure, absolutely. I mentioned in my sort of opening that one of the things my team does is run research and development projects and proofs of concept for the organization. So we have a pretty well-defined internal quality management system, which I also owned, that requires, and if you know anything about quality, it requires that you hypothesize, test, launch, have your measurements in place, and a feedback loop. So one of the things that we do is working with the enterprise, go through the pilots and the proof of concept. And proof of concept is sort of off stage. And then when we get to the point where we want to do a field test, that's our pilot. So in the pilots, what we do is make sure that we have the right measurements, we have the right feedback loops. Those are built into and then institutionalized and industrialized as a part of our process. So that, you know, once I run a pilot and the measurements tell me that, yes, we have improved our service to our customers, I can now tell Gloria exactly when her package will arrive, and if it will not, why not, and when she can expect it. We take that learning, and it is a part of our now standard process to feed that information back into the system so that the system gets to learn with each positive result we have and each mistake that we make. So the only way to do it really is to practice good feedback and institutionalization of new process that supports getting the right information, getting it updated and available real time, which is what we focus on, real time to the folks who have to use it in the field.
Gotcha. Debo and Karim, do you want to speak to that?
It's not too much to add. That was a great answer.
Okay.
I think as a product guy, we use standard software lifecycle management techniques, right? You're still applying that even to your models, to your code. You're getting the feedback in from your tests when you deploy at your customer. You're training their models as it exists. You know, it's the same, you know, you're managing. It's not one and done. Mm-hmm. And so we all have processes, you know, that we use to kind of like manage the iterations, right, against your sprints.
You can just think about it as the difference between Siri and Google Assistant. Hope this is not being recorded. Siri got shittier and shittier over time, and Google Assistant has got better, better and better over time. That's the difference. Between, you know, if
that's interesting.
Yeah. Hello, my name is Richard Golding. I own a construction company, and I'm a developer in New York. How do you see AI disrupting the construction industry?
Oh.
So I'll take that one, Stud, because I spend a lot of time with buildings and facilities. It's actually quite intriguing. I'll give you a couple of quick examples. If you think about the thing being built itself, right, so the building or the structure, those are becoming more and more instrumented, the tunnel, the roadway, right? And the disruption comes from the fact that you can now take data from them and begin to drive different kind of, you know, profiles around how it's being used, how it's going to be maintained, right, how you're going to optimize it in different ways. So I just think the fact that the structures themselves are becoming more instrumented is an ongoing change. I'm also seeing a change in how people are engaging in their processes. As you well know, construction involves a lot of equipment, right? And so you're dealing with the operating equipment efficiency. You're dealing with questions around, you know, what's the right maintenance, when can I take it down, keep it up, and stuff like that. Another side of this, and I'll give you this one just for a fun fact, think about the production of cement, right? There's a relationship between the temperature of the kiln, the granularity of the crusher that is grinding it, and the energy that you consume, and the quality of the cement. So when you look at people looking at how they were going to optimize that production line to deliver cement at a certain quality and then move it out through their supply chain, I mean, you're talking about changes in manufacturing, just-in-time notions that will fundamentally change how we all are interacting downstream and upstream of these processes. I think underpinning it all is instrumentation and data. And to your point of what the heck is IoT, which I do know what you know about, that's the power of it. This whole industrial IoT form is transforming everything by data, and we're using AI to make sense of the data and drive useful outcomes.
Thank you.
I would actually add to that. I think you said if you're a developer, if you think about AI and as a developer, where do I place my next bet? Yep. AI helps you identify, use all sorts of data that in the past would be too disparate to put together. It's, you know, mathematical data plus social media data. You can put all of that together in an AI tool and make a much better decision as to where you invest next.
Thank you.
Disruptive across a lot of industries.
Hello, my name is Steve Jovi Soje. I want to see if you can advise the Black community on how they can raise young Black people to like be well trained for this AI, because this is a new kind of way of approaching problem in the present world, so that we can raise kids, Black kids, that can, you know, stand in front of machine learning. They can bring the Black culture into it, because most of the time, you guys were talking about how AI is not only about coding, but we still need people to code, because most of the Black community, we are not like into that. So how do we get ourselves more involved in it so that it doesn't look like it's only a white thing? So what's the advice you can give to parents, people that are here, people that want to learn, and how they can go ahead? Because AI is going to like generate jobs that are not yet even, doesn't have a title yet. So what is the advice you can give? Sorry, my question is so long.
And I think we kind of sort of touched on that. We talked about what skills, but I think an interesting point you bring up is how do you foster the interest?
I think we have to figure out how to build kids who are curious and want to continue to learn. Because the it's like you said, there are three choices, and then there are other choices that are around a fixed skill set. I know how to type, and that's what I will do the rest of my life. I think one of the reasons I am where I am, I started out as a lawyer. I wasn't kidding about that. And now I do advanced technologies. And it's because my parents focused on raising children who were curious about the world and interested and felt that they could actually, because we were smart enough, because we were assertive, could actually be flexible and do what we needed. So teach your kids, allow them to be creative, encourage them to be creative, and encourage them to be curious. If you get there, then they will not be intimidated by disciplines that are focused on continuous learning and are focused on really applying their intellect and that curiosity.
That's a great answer. And Kareem and Deb, I just want to get a little controversial, because you know there's a lot of talk about African Americans and our children and our education not having that same spark and that same skill set at the STEM level as children from Africa and from the African diaspora. What can the African American education system learn?
Kids from Africa, this is
yeah, I'm gonna put you on the spot. What can we learn, or what can we exchange from each other? So, you know, we've seen so many innovators and engineers coming out of the African continent. What are the lessons to learn in American culture from that?
Lead on, brother. I'm right behind you.
I can't wait to hear what you say.
Got me on this. First of all, I would say I know a ton of extremely bright, awesome African Americans in technology. Yeah. Aston Motes was the first engineer, first employee, period, at Dropbox. Yeah. Dr. Paul Judge is extremely well-known.
Oh, he is brilliant.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, first of all, I think there are a ton of African American entrepreneurs and innovators that are extremely bright. So I'm done. No, just kidding. So, so I would say, you know, for me personally, my parents really valued education. They really valued learning, and you'll find this is probably the case with most African parents, at least for those of us out here in the U.S. So it started from a very young age that our parents really value education, and then it's not enough. I think what she said applies a lot, where the kid has to then themselves be very passionate, very interested, very curious. And so once you have the parents set the tone that this is really important, that, you know, 100% is not enough, you have to get 105%, mm-hmm. and things like that, you set the expectation of the children that this is really important, education is important, and then the children kind of take it on from there. What I did want to say is I don't want us to get the sense that AI is this mysterious, very incredibly difficult thing. It's actually just, you know, if you have certain basics in math, certain basics in, you know, statistics, certain basics in like critical thinking, you can get very far. And there are a lot of online resources available where you can go from zero to actually deploying something real in 8 weeks, you know. And there are many resources, Google, you can just Google them, and just have that confidence that you can do it. And they start from kind of, I'm a beginner, to I'm someone who has a degree, and so on and so forth. And then there's one specific program that I want to call out, started by one of my friends, Dr. Mustafa Cisse. He's leading the Google Research Center, Google AI Research Center in Ghana. So they opened mm-hmm. a research center in Africa. I don't think it matters it's in Africa, but there's a master's program that they're doing for folks who have certain basic backgrounds in math, and you can go and you can enroll in this master's program. So if you look, there are actually lots of opportunities for Black folks, for Africans, to get into AI. And I just want to say that the background needed to actually get in, there is some background, but it's actually not as inscrutable as it may be made out to seem.
And Kareem, you wanted to?
Yeah, so if I was to truly answer your question the way given, it's kind of, I think when I look back historically for, you know, the options available, right? So being African in my case, being British born Nigerian, My parents did not, you know, the notion of sports was just not an option for a career. So we just didn't have, the, you know, it's what's available to you, right? So, you know, your mother would be like, what do you mean you want to play football? Right? It just does not occur. So you had maybe that drive in, but I don't actually subscribe to the, oh, Africans are good at this and African Americans are good at that. I think we have a lot more choices. My kids are being raised here and they have a much richer and much more creative, you know, kind of footprint than I ever had access to, and I think they'll be much better humans for it, to be honest with you. So I think actually at the end of the day, it really comes down to being intellectually curious. I do agree with this point. I don't think that any of this stuff is inaccessible to anyone. As I said, I think that there are many ways to play. You know, last year we had, or the year before last, we had a producer, a music producer, who was using Watson to, you know, compose new music, right? Changing the dynamic of how you create music, leveraging AI, and you know the samples he had brought in and stuff like that, right? So you know there are new ways to redefine the realm of the possible to participate in this, you know, kind of you know new economies. And so I really think for our kids and for ourselves, it's really about being intellectually curious and intellectually open, and then you really can just tap into anything in whatever way makes sense for you. So stay authentic and true to yourself, whatever that might be, right? Sounds don't good. Wake up tomorrow and say, I want to go play being a data scientist and you can't stand statistics, right? I don't like statistics. So, you know, just don't do it, right?
Yeah, I think that's great advice too. Thank you. And I think we have time for one last question.
Yeah, last question. I'm gonna get really a little deep technically.
Go for it.
Debo and Kareem, so excellent panel. So I'm Maynard Holiday from the RAND Corporation. When you use the systems to do your AI, are they CPU, GPU, or TensorFlow based? And based on you know whatever the architecture is, what are the results that you're seeing using any of those three, you know, processing? You know, architectures?
I'll give a real short answer, all of the above, right? That just depends upon the problem, right, that we're solving. Image ones tend to become very GPU intensive, mm-hmm. right? Others, we use TensorFlow, we use other models. It really is actually about mapping the problem space to the architecture and technique that's available to us.
Yeah, I'll just add that in terms of results, computers can now computers now have superhuman abilities in vision, so that we can actually, in image classification, we actually do much better than humans, than a single human. So the sort of state of the art there that's easy to kind of benchmark with human performance.
Well, with that, I want to thank our panelists, Gloria, Debo, and Kareem. Thank you for this very insightful session on AI, and thank you so much for being with us.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you.